Hello, hello, Mordimer here, and welcome to the grand final of Chessable Masters 2020. We have the best players of the tournament. Of course, first they had to get to the quarterfinals, then win their games in the quarterfinals. Magnus Carlsen won against Fabiano Caruana, Anish Giri won against Alexander Grischuk. Then we had the semifinals where Magnus Carlsen beat Ding Liren, and Anish Giri won against Jan Nepomniachtchi, and now we have grand final, and I would like to show you what happened in the first game. So Anish Giri and Magnus Carlsen draw first game, and then Magnus won in the second game. Magnus won in the end game. Anish played some inaccuracy, and Magnus remaneuvered the rook and just created something out of nothing. But the game was very interesting, and Anish played really, really well, but that was not enough. Then we had another draw, and this is the game number four. And Anish Giri doesn't have a choice. He has to win as black. And playing against Magnus Carlsen with the black pieces, where you have to win. That's definitely a very difficult task. So without further ado, let's see what happened on the board in this exciting game. Magnus Carlsen opens with a4. We have c5, so Sicilian defense. Knight on f3, d6, pretty standard stuff. And now bishop on b5, Moscow variation. And now bishop on d7, of course, is possible. Just exchange variation. It's very popular after bishop on d7, queen d7. Just castle, normal development on c6. And then c3, d4, and the game, you know, continues. So this is, of course, possible. However, Anish Giri prefers to keep most of the pieces on the board as he fights for the win. So knight on d7 variation. And now the main line here is, of course, d4. And after c takes on d4, queen on d4, as this knight cannot come to c6. So queen can stay in the center for a while and help in the center. However, Magnus goes for the sideline, and he played a4. We have knight on f6 by Anish Giri, knight on c3, and now g6. a5, so advancing the pawn even further, and now bishop on g7. We have castle by Magnus Carlsen, and now a6, kicking the bishop. Bishop goes back to e2, and now castle by Giri. Rook on e1, and now we have the position which was reached a couple of times on the top level, maybe not between the super grandmasters. Knight on b8 was the, you know, main move here. So the knight did the job, saved the light square bishop, and now the knight can go to c6. This is the main idea. Also e5 is possible, just prevent e5 playing by white, which can be very, very unpleasant. However, Anish Giri plays something new. It's kind of novelty, and b5. So this pawn already make two moves, and now gonna make the third move, a takes on b6, en passant. We have bishop on b7, and now d3 by Magnus Carlsen, knight on b6, and now e5, in the spirit of this opening. We have knight f on d5, exchanging the knights, and now exchanging also the pawns on d6, and now c3, preparing d4, which is of course the main plan for white in these openings. We have rook on e8, and now bishop on d2 first, which Anish Giri tried to exploit, and he improves the position of his queen with tempo, focusing on b2 now. We have queen on c2, defending, and now a5. So now, for example, making the space for the bishop, if needed, also the pawn can be pushed and block the queen side of the white. We have h3, making some breathing space for the king. Bishop on c6, and now, as planned, d4 by Magnus Carlsen, fighting for the center. C takes on d4, knight takes on d4, and now the move which Magnus Carlsen has to react somehow. Knight on b4. Attacking the queen and asking Magnus, what are you gonna do about that? Do you want to exchange the knights or not? And Magnus said in the interview that he was calculating queen on d1, and look how deep is calculation of Magnus Carlsen. He calculated this way: bishop on d4, c takes on d4, queen takes on d4, and after bishop on c3, exchanging the queens, bishop on d1, exchanging also the rooks, and now knight on d3, attacking this bishop. So bishop on a5, winning back the pawn, and after knight on b2, black gonna have extra pawn. He also said, okay, bishop on e2, and the game can continue. Black has extra pawn, so probably not really great for me. Something he didn't calculate, however, is queen on c1. Because this way he would not lose the pawn. The point is after bishop on d4, c takes on d4, queen on d4 is not possible anymore. So black would have to play something like queen on b7, but it's nothing dangerous here. The point is if the pawn is taken, then actually bishop on b4 winning this bishop, because that was the defender, the knight was the defender of the bishop. So after queen on b4, white of course is winning. So probably queen on c1 was the way to go here. However, Magnus also said, I was sure that after c takes on b4, I'm winning here. And what happened in the game? We have bishop on d4, now threatening to take on f2. And Magnus first take on a5, attacking the queen. And queen has nowhere to go here. But of course, Anish Giri can make a space for the queen. So we have bishop on f2 with check, king on f1, and now queen can jump to d4. And here is the critical moment of the game. What would you play as white in this position? It's very, very tricky position. So for example, if you don't like this queen and you want to kick the queen, which is very natural, of course, and play something like bishop on c3. Look at this. Queen on h4 wins the game. If you want to move the rook, the problem is you cannot, because bishop g2, and you don't have the choice. You have to take the bishop, because this bishop is controlling all the squares. So king on g2, and that would be a checkmate. So you cannot do that. Also, if you try queen on d3, defending this way, then bishop c5. And now this is a checkmate. If you bring the queen, the problem is you cannot, because you're gonna lose the queen. And if you play g3, look at this. This is almost the Boden mate. This diagonal is controlled. This pieces actually helping to checkmate a white king. And I hope you see already, it's the same pattern like in the Boden mate. Queen on h3. If you don't know what is the Boden mate, then I show already three games and I explain this really, really well. So feel free to actually check this really helpful video. Finally, if you try something like bishop on f3 and solidify the position, maybe give up the exchange, it doesn't work. And this would be the most beautiful ending if it happened, because bishop on b5 with check. And let's say rook on e2, but it doesn't matter, because now bishop on a7. And here is the checkmate, as the rook is, as you see, pinned. The only move to defend is bishop on e1, defending, but now queen can come to d4, and look at this. Checkmate is coming on g1, you can do nothing about that. You just gonna be checkmated over there. Beautiful stuff. What Magnus Carlsen, the only option actually to continue the game is queen on c3. Queen on c3, this is what he should play. And after queen on c3, bishop e1, rook on e1, Magnus would have to play being down the exchange. However, he has disconnected passed pawn, so this passed pawn gonna support the advanced a5 pawn, and also have the pair of bishop. So it's still playable, but that's the best position he could actually get. However, he took the bishop on c6. So now feel free to pause the video and find the winning continuation for Anish Giri. So finish off the world champion. Enjoy that while I enjoy my cup of tea. So, are you ready? Because first I will show you the continuation which was calculated by Anish Giri as first and also by Magnus Carlsen. So he was sure everything is fine with his position. He calculated that bishop on h4 with the idea of mating on f2. So that's the idea, but it doesn't work because of g3. But not queen on f3, because that would be a draw. Black would just take on d2, equalize the material and continue, but rather g3. g3 is winning here, because after bishop on g3, queen on f3, and now if black decide to take the bishop, then of course this bishop would fall, and if bishop on e1, this is the analysis by Anish Giri and actually by Magnus Carlsen, who showed the line to the end. It's pretty impressive, because I prepared first by myself and then I check what Magnus has to say, and he showed the line, you know, much deeper. So let's see again how Magnus calculated all of that. So bishop on e1, and then after queen on b2, bishop on c3, attacking the queen, defending the rook. So queen on c2, and here most of the people would end the analysis, however not Magnus. He continues bishop on c4, now attacking f7, so rook on a7, and now queen f6, threatening the checkmate. So the only move is to rook on e5. And now queen d8 with check, king on g7, now bishop e5 with check, d takes on e5, and queen on d3, and white is up in material, have the bishop for 2 points, so it should be definitely winning, especially this advanced passed pawn is just too strong, and it's gonna win the game. So this is what Magnus Carlsen calculated playing queen on c6. It doesn't work, but Anish Giri played something much simpler, and I hope you found it. Bishop on e1, winning the exchange and threatening the checkmate. So pretty neat idea. Also, the bishop is hanging, okay? So we have bishop on e1, and after queen on b2, Magnus Carlsen, believe me or not, resigned. He resigned because rook is under attack, and also the bishop is under attack, and you cannot defend both of them. Okay, if you move the rook, you're gonna lose the bishop, and now you have to play this endgame where you are down material, you are literally exchanged down, and the pawn as well. So black is completely winning here. This is why after queen on b2, Magnus Carlsen resigned the game. So this was game number 4, and two another games gonna be the blitz games. I will show you one of the games, and then if these games not decide, then we gonna have Armageddon. So stay tuned, and if you like this video, press like, and for some reason if you don't like it, press unlike and press subscribe, smash the bell button. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.